nor was Britain bound by treaty obligations, as the Foreign Secretary, Edward Grey, assured Parliament.
We are not parties to the Franco-Russian alliance. We do not even know the terms of the alliance.
But in private, Grey and other leaders knew that Britain had to fight. If Britain stayed neutral, the war would still threaten the country's vast empire, its global trade and security. And Britain needed to stay on friendly terms with France and Russia. Even in peacetime, she was not powerful enough to defend her empire against everyone. In Africa and India, the safety of Britain's colonies depended on French and Russian goodwill. In 1914, Britain feared her friends just as much as her enemies.
If we fail Russia now, we cannot hope to maintain that friendly cooperation with her in Asia that is of such vital importance to us.
Above all, Britain could never afford to have Europe dominated by a triumphant Germany. If Germany overran the Channel ports, Britain's control of the seas would be under threat. Prime Minister Herbert Asquith took a pragmatic view.
It is quite against British interests that France should be wiped out.
At 11 p.m. on the 4th of August, Britain declared war on Germany.
It was like awaiting the signal for the pulling of a lever which would hurl millions to their doom. The deep notes of Big Ben rang out into the night, the first strokes in Britain's most fateful hour since she arose out of the deep. Every face was suddenly contracted into a painful intensity.
It's horrible to think of all the suffering which may follow our mobilization. I suppose the less one thinks of it, the better.
We never talk of death and very seldom think much about it. It's when everyone is asleep and you are awake that sometimes you look into the future and wonder.
The British government had a war book listing all that had to be done in an emergency. The country's leaders knew war would be a long and painful struggle, a slow, grinding process of blockade, of starving the enemy out. But most civilians had no idea what they were getting into. Across Europe, there was a run on the banks. The war couldn't last longer than a year, the French finance minister told a British general, because the money to pay for it would run out. Most people expected Britain, with the largest navy in the world, to fight a sea war. The Foreign Secretary reassured the nation.
For us, with a powerful fleet, which we believe able to protect our commerce, to protect our shores, and to protect our interests, if we are engaged in war, we shall suffer but little more than we shall suffer if we stand aside.
Bert Fielder was a sergeant in the Royal Marines. He reassured his wife.
My dear Nell, I don't think this war is going to be half as bad as people expect it to be. You see, it's not a hard job for England, so there's no need to worry yourself. As long as I can keep you informed as to where I am, it'll all be all right.
But the weapons with which the world went to war were so new that few had ever been fired in anger. Countries were armed with battleships and submarines less than 10 years old. Nobody really knew how to use them. All the European powers had been stockpiling new artillery, machine guns, explosive shells. But none had fought a major war in Europe for over 40 years. The crisis had begun in the Balkans. And as the Austrians faced up to the Serbs, the First World War started here, as it would go on everywhere else. A war in which old scores would be settled and the rule book thrown away.
The war is taking us into a country inhabited by a population inspired with fanatical hatred towards ourselves. an attitude of extreme severity, extreme harshness, and extreme distrust is to be observed towards everybody.
In some sectors, Serbian civilians did fight a guerrilla war, not in uniform, not in the regular army. It was hard for the Austrians to tell who was a real enemy, who was not. But their reprisals against the Serbian people were vicious. This was a war of nationalities and races. Not just against an enemy army, but against whole peoples. In the first month of the war, 4,000 civilians in western Serbia were killed or disappeared.
They burned houses down, looted, raped, killed. 17 people, all women, girls, children tied with rope, dead in a ditch by the road. All of them slaughtered.
At 9 a.m., I went to Lezhnica to get some supplies for the battery. In the town, you could see the atrocities left behind by the enemy. Ten people, some children among them, had been hanged near the church. About 100 people, their throats cut at the railway station. A terrible sight to cast your eyes on.
At the Serbian town of Prinjava, this memorial commemorates those who died. The Serbian government commissioned a report into the massacres by a Swiss doctor, Rodolf Reis.
The massacres of the civil population were systematically organized by the command of the invading army. It's upon the command that all responsibility must rest, and also the disgrace with which this army has covered itself for all time.
Austria-Hungary was far less ruthless when it came to fighting the Serbian army. That too set a pattern for the war, a foretaste of the military weakness which would dog Austria-Hungary's partnership with Germany. This was a war in which events on one front could have a critical effect on another. Germany was relying on her ally Austria-Hungary to hold the Eastern Front. With Russia massing on her borders, Germany was horrified to learn Austria had concentrated her reserves not against Russia, but down in the Balkans to deal with Serbia. Meanwhile, the main Serbian army had marched up from the south of the country, gathering numbers as it went. On the 12th of August, it finally met the Austrians at Sayre Mountain.